So without further ado, I think I'll get us started here. I'd like to introduce Dennis DeLay. Dennis is the economist at the New Hampshire Center for Public Policy Studies, and he's also the New Hampshire forecast manager for the New England Economic Partnership, which is a nonprofit organization dedicated to providing objective economic analyses and forecasts. He has a 30-year record of success in economic development, policy analysis, forecasting, regional business expertise, and public speaking. And he's a recognized expert in regional and national economics. Since 2006, he's been an adjunct professor with New England College. Dennis is a 1972 graduate of St. Anselm College with a BA in economics. He and his wife, Marilyn, and their three daughters reside in Manchester. Dennis joined us last year, and it's wonderful to have you back again, Dennis. So thank you.
Thanks very much. I appreciate being here.
Yeah. So, Dennis, I'm going to hand the presentation over to you. So within a few seconds, you should be getting a little pop-up box on your computer. Has it come through yet? Nice.
Yes.
Excellent. So thank you. So take it away.
All right. Okay. So, great. My apologies if this is the first time I've participated in a lot of webinars. This is the first time I've been a speaker at one. So. So I appreciate your indulgence. What I want to cover today is some material very similar to what I covered a year ago. I just want to go through how you would create a community economic profile for your geographic area. And so that could be a town, it could be a group of towns, it could be a region, a county in New Hampshire. I'll do a quick overview using largely a website that is available from the Department of Employment Security called Community Profiles. And most of the examples I'll show will be for the city of Concord and for the surrounding towns. And then we'll dig behind that a little bit just to see where all of that data comes from. I also want to talk a little bit about some of the sources of data and some of the things you should be thinking about when you define either a geographic area or use survey data, in particular from the Census Bureau. So let me get started. And again, I will leave 10 minutes or so for questions at the end, so keep those in mind. So basically three areas I want to cover: data analysis, making sense of it, developing an economic profile, trying to understand what the information we're going to get about our community or our region tells us, and then, as I said, dig behind it and talk a little bit about where to find a lot of this information and how to go to the source, and maybe dig a little deeper than what might be available from a website like the Department of Employment Security Community Profiles. Just a couple of tips, I think, about data analysis and how to present data. It's always helpful, I think, for your audience to compare your community or your region to the county, to the state, and national averages. And what I mean by that is if you want to show something like the poverty rate for your region or your community, it's always helpful, I think, to put that in the context of what similar statistic like poverty looks like for the county, for the state, or for the national average. It's always helpful, I think, and always more helpful to show data proportionally. You could report something like the total amount of taxes that are collected in your community, but again, that could be several million dollars, but that's not a number that's particularly meaningful to people. So showing data proportionally, for instance, property tax collections as a percent of the total income in your community, median income per household, family income per household, I think, again, helps people connect with the data. A significant amount of data that's put out by federal and state agencies can vary quite a bit from 1 month to another, or even from 1 year to another. So sometimes it's best to consider smoothing data over time. Instead of showing, for example, the poverty rate for 1 year, you may want to show the poverty rate for a 3-year or 5-year average. And so the final thing is always show the data source, where you got the information. And again, it could just be a very simple line, something like the source is the American Community Survey from the Census Bureau. That not only helps your audience, but it also helps you, because probably next year you're going to be updating all of this information, and you want to be able to keep track of where you got it. So just a quick overview, I think, of the kind of things that you should make available to people when you're developing a community profile. An overview of the area, I think, is important. Some focus on demographics, the people in your area. A few tables on what the economy looks like, and that can be in terms of total amount of gross state product or the number of jobs and the type of jobs that are in your area. Data on income and poverty, I already addressed. Housing data, I think that's always helpful. What's the average home selling price in your area? What's the median rent in your area? Commuting patterns, if you can get them. Actually, you can get a significant amount of data like that from, again, the American Community Survey, which I'll talk about a little bit more in detail. And land use and development, tax rates, property tax value, what percentage of the property tax in your area is paid by residential versus commercial and industrial establishments. I think that's all good information to have. It's always good to start with a map, just so you can show people where you are, and some summary statistics like the land area, the population, how some very basic housing data, employment, and political boundaries. As far as creating a map, that's pretty easy to do. You could do that in Google or in Yahoo. This is a map that I created just in a couple of minutes by doing a search on google.com. Just put in the search term Concord, New Hampshire, and the first thing to come up on the web page is a map of Concord, which is actually pretty detailed considering that it's free from Google Maps. And you can see the boundary, the political boundaries of Concord. You can see some of the highlights in the area where the watershed is, the major highways, and so forth. Again, so that's free and very easy to do. This is a page from the Department of Employment Security's website, and they have it's actually one of the most visited parts of the Department of Employment Security website, probably by an order of magnitude. I think there are 10 times more hits on this part of their website than any of the other information that they provide to the public. And if you go to the community profiles part of the Employment Security website, there's a list of towns you click on, in this case the town of Concord, and what comes up is some basic information about who to contact for economic development issues in Concord, phone number, email, what county Concord is in, the labor market area, which is important if you're developing data on employment statistics, the tourism region, that's another way that the state has been divided up, what planning commission Concord belongs to, what economic development group Concord belongs to, that's the regional development, and capital regional development is the economic development group. Other political statistics like the congressional district, which executive council district Concord's in, the district for the state senate, and so on. And then you can see at the bottom, it might be a little bit hard to read, but again, the slides will be available to you as part of the presentation. just a little history on Concord and how it was founded. And you can see Concord in the green on the map. This is another, actually, part of our website at nhpolicy.org a couple of years ago. When the 2010 census data came out, we created an online Google map, clickable on our website, where you can just click on a town in the state, and up pops a little information box showing the population, the number of people per square mile, population under 18 and over 65 in percentage terms, and then a comparison to the state average. And that, again, that's still on our website if you're interested in taking a look at that for the town or region that you were in. I think that would be helpful. But again, this is not only a source of information, but to give you an idea of the kind of information you may want to provide as part of a regional profile. So, data on people that I talked about a few minutes ago. I think you probably want to show information on the number of the number of people, households, if there's a forecast available for those things. That's, I think, always of interest to people. Population by age and gender. Educational attainment. What percentage of the population in your area has a high school degree or a bachelor's degree or better. Types of households. The split between owner households and rental households. Again, that data is available and I think of interest to people. Number of people per household. And although it's probably not of as much interest in New Hampshire, population by race and ethnicity. And this is, again, a table from the Community Profiles website, which shows a lot of that information. And I think shows a number of the other things that I was talking about earlier. This, again, is for Concord. It shows the number of people in the community at the top of the table and also the number of people in Merrimack County for the census years 70 to 2010 and also the latest estimate we have for 2013. That's followed by a breakdown of people by gender for the latest year for which we have data, a breakdown of people by age group. The median age in Concord is about 40.1 years, and the percentage of the population in Concord that has a high school degree or better or a bachelor's degree or better. Looking at economic statistics for your community, again, employment within the community, employment by industry. If you do have access to a forecast or if you've made a forecast yourself, I think that's always of interest. What's the average wage that's paid by industries in your area and the average unemployment rate? And again, here's another example of that, again for Concord, again from the Community Profiles website at the Department of Employment Security. At the top you see over a 10-year period a comparison in Concord of the number of people in the civilian labor force, number of people who are unemployed, the unemployment rate, and then a breakdown. Really, this is a very sort of top-level breakdown of the type of industries that are doing business in Concord. Goods producing are manufacturing and construction industries. Service producing is pretty much everything else in the private sector, so that includes retail trade and hospitals and education. And the government sector, as you can see, actually is a pretty large part of the total. That's not surprising, again, because Concord is essentially the state capital, and so a lot of government offices and government employees, particularly state employees, are in Concord. Income and poverty, my suggestion would be to present statistics on median household income, per capita income, and the percent of the population below the federal poverty level. And again, this comes from the Community Profile website for Concord. I should mention, too, if you noticed that these tables all show the source of the data in parentheses. So at the top of the annual income table, that ACS stands for American Community Survey. It's a five-year average estimate of all of these statistics for the period 2009 to 2013. And you can see the labor force data at the bottom. Again, civilian labor force, number of people employed, the unemployment rate, and so forth. Housing. Lots of statistics that can be put together on the housing sector in your community. The type of housing, the number of housing units that have been permitted over the last several years. If there's new affordable housing that's been built in your community or in your region. Home ownership, median housing value, the median rent, and the number of home sales if you have it for your area. And again, here's an example of that, again from Concord, again from the Community Profiles website. This shows the property tax rate for Concord, the equalization ratio, and one divided into the other gives you the full value tax rate for Concord, and then assessed value by property type. I think this is always interesting to folks to sort of look at how much of the property tax is coming from residential as opposed to commercial land and buildings. Again, the ACS is the source for statistics like total housing units and number of units in structures, how many mobile homes are in the area, and again, the ACS is the source for that. Land use, acreage, undeveloped land, miles of major roadway if you have it, permits for commercial, industrial, and for residential structures, I think, are always interesting. If you have information on the total square footage that's available, or even the total square footage that's vacant in your area, that's always maybe of interest to people involved in the economic development field thinking about expanding in your area. And this is one of the last areas, I think, that's always of interest to people, commuting. And how do people get around in your area? What's the means of transportation of work? What's the mean travel time? Commuting patterns, where do people go to that live in your community, and where do they come from to work in your community? Again, that's data that's available from the Census and the American Community Survey. And again, this is my final example of those types of statistics. Again, a lot of this comes on the left-hand side. That data is all from the American Community Survey. They actually do ask a question on that survey that the Census does on the percentage of people that are driving alone to work, whether they're carpooling, whether they're taking public transportation, and the mean travel time to work, and also the percent of residents that are working in the community and commuting to jobs outside the community. And over on the right-hand side, that's really data that you can get from reading a map or there's the ability on Google Maps to put pins in a part of the map and calculate driving distance to selected cities. So you can see on the right-hand side, Department of Employment Security, not only that we calculated or showed some statistics on the major interstates in the Concord area and the names of the public transportation services, but also did a calculation of how long or how far it is to get from Concord to Manchester, to Portland, Maine, to Boston, to New York, and to Montreal. So where do you get all of this information? Well, everything that I've just showed you, as I said, is available on the Department of Employment Security website under the Community Profile section, and I'll show you the URL for that in a second. The Economic and Labor Market Information Bureau of the Department of Employment Security, that's what ELMI stands for, is also the source for just about all of the labor force, unemployment, employment, jobs, and wages data for the state, for the counties, for labor market areas, and for your individual communities. The census and the American Community Survey are sources, as I've said, for pretty much everything that you need to know about population and households. There are other data that I think is of interest, and I'll touch on it briefly and show you where to get it. The Bureau of Economic Analysis has a portion of their website that they call Bare Facts. It contains regional data. It's mostly at the county level for income data and some employment data. There's also something called County Business Patterns, and which actually publishes some data at the zip code level, if you're interested in looking in that. The Internal Revenue Service has a portion of their website that they call Statistics of Income, and from that you can get statistics summarized to the county level, to the state level, and the zip code level, number of people that have paid taxes, the average income of those people, statistics on the number of people participating in the earned income tax credit, and other data. The New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority collects a lot of data on housing in the state and makes it available on their website, fairly easy to access, and that will include average home selling price. The New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority does an annual survey of rents around the state, and although the document that they publish that data in shows data pretty much just down to the county level and for major cities, there's also part of the New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority website that you can visit where you can get data for individual towns. And our Department of Revenue has really all of the data on property taxes and state and local finance data that's, again, might be of interest to people that you're developing the community profile for. So here's where I got virtually all of the data that I showed you in the first set of slides. At the beginning, the Economic and Labor Market Information Bureau keeps this community profile as part of their website. Which shows data at the town level. They update it frequently. I think they just updated all the data a few months ago for the most recent American Community Survey. The URL is there. And again, I encourage you to take a look at it because it's an excellent place to start. That's not to say that you couldn't go beyond the data that they present, but they've already done a lot of the work for you if you're looking to create town data for your community profile. As I said, the Economic and Labor Market Information Bureau is also the source of in the state of data on employment, wages by industry, occupation, and projections. Does somebody have a question? Is that one hearing something? Okay, keep going. The American Community Survey, this is done by the Census Bureau, U.S. Census Bureau, and I think most of you are familiar with the census that's done every 10 years on the, in the years that are end in zero. So we had a census in 2000 and a census in 2010. It used to be that in the census year, the census would also collect a lot of, would not only count the number of people and households all across the country, but would also collect a lot of data on socio and economic characteristics of the population, things like income, poverty, commuting, education, race and ethnicity. What the census a few years ago, it was between the 2000 and 2010 census. Essentially,
oh, no apologies, messing it almost over.
Hello.
We know you're a busy guy and trying to get everybody's in this business these days, trying to get everybody's schedule synced up is always a tough thing. So.
Yeah.
Could you?
I understand.
I'm sorry. Could you mute, please? Thank you. So the American Community Survey now is the tool that is being used by the census to collect what I call the good stuff, income, poverty, commuting, education, race, and so on. The New Hampshire Office of Energy and Planning keeps the latest census data available on their website, and there are the URLs for that. If you want to go right to the source, though, the Census Bureau has a tool called American Fact Finder. It's pretty easy to use. And the URL is there. I'm not going to demonstrate that tool, but I certainly can talk about it more in the Q&A session. Something that you should keep in mind when you're accessing data from the American Community Survey is that they have their own set of data sets and statistical issues that are probably important for you to keep in mind. The background on this is that the American Community Survey is done every year, but it's a much smaller sample size than what was done in the previous census years. In the year 2000, as an example, the sort of survey that was done in that year to collect what I, again, call the good stuff, was about a 15% sample. The ACS that replaces that surveys only about 5% of the population at any one time. So what the American Community Survey data sets have been constructed to do is to produce data that depending upon the size of the geographic area. There are one-year estimates for areas that are 65,000 people or more. So you can get one-year summary data at the state level for every state in the country, and in New Hampshire's case for the largest counties. Three-year estimates or three-year averages data is released both for the larger areas and for areas that are slightly smaller, 20,000 people or more. When you're thinking about getting data for a town or for a census tract or even for a zip code area, you really have to go to the five-year estimates. So that's for the five-year ACS. Is for areas that are have less than 20,000 people in them, which obviously would include a significant number of the towns in New Hampshire. So that's why when I was talking before about ACS estimates being a five-year average, 2009 to 2013, essentially that's what it means. In order to get data that's statistically significant for small geographic areas, you really have to go to the five-year estimates. Let me just talk about geography for a second. There's a lot of ways to look at and a lot of data that you can get for geographic areas. This is probably the most commonly way of thinking about geography at the municipal or political boundary level. So this just shows you a map of the Concord area and the towns that surround Concord. And again, data is available in most cases at the town level from the ACS. Some of the employment data is available by town as well. But you'll get, when you go to sources like the ACS or the employment data from the Department of Employment Security, you'll find that there's more detail to the data for larger geographic areas. So, for example, Department of Employment Security might have total number of jobs in Concord, but you're not going to get much of a breakdown by type of jobs. However, if you expanded the area you want to look at to the greater Concord area, you'd probably be able to get data on number of manufacturing jobs, number of trade jobs, number of construction jobs, and so forth. So again, the thing to keep in mind is sometimes if you really want to know how many construction jobs are in your town, you're probably not going to be able to get that kind of information, but you could get it for a region that includes your town. Zip codes, again, data from the Survey of Manufacturers and County Business Patterns is available at the zip code level. Some of the ACS data is available at the zip code level. Something to keep in mind, though, zip codes aren't quite towns. And, maybe the best way to show you that is just go back to the previous slide. Hillsboro and Deering in the lower left-hand corner, those are separate towns. But when you're looking at that geographic area by zip code, you can see that that zip code 03244 essentially includes Hillsboro and Deering. So, then you see, two or three zip codes that cover the Concord area. So, just keep in mind if you're pulling data by zip code, you want to make sure that that actually matches the geography that you think it does. You can also pull data by census tract, and that's a geography that's constructed by the Census Bureau. It's 3,000 to 5,000 people per area, and to the extent they can, the census tries not to divide up a town, but there may be more than one census tract in a town. So if you recall the map that I was showing you a few minutes ago for Concord, I'll go back to it. There's Concord sort of in the center of the polygon. And if you look at Concord from a census tract level, you can see you can get a lot of data for neighborhoods in Concord, at least as defined by the census. You can see the concentration of census tract numbers in the general Concord area. But at the same time, if you move outside of Concord, because the census is grouping areas based on the number of people, and again, the breakpoint that they like to use is about 3,000 to 5,000 people. You can see over in the upper left-hand corner, they combine a couple of towns into one census tract. So again, geography is an important thing to think about when you're thinking about pulling data together. Another thing to think about is that a particular town might belong to different regions depending upon how people that define regions make that definition, and you could have a differing number of towns within that regional grouping. So this is just a quick view of the city of Concord. The city of Concord is part of the Central New Hampshire Regional Planning Commission region. There's about 20 other or 20 towns total in that area. Concord is also part, in Merrimack County. That includes 27 towns. As the Department of Employment Security defines the labor market, which they've nicknamed the Concord New Hampshire Micropolitan NECTA, it consists of 12 towns. The old definition, Concord was a part of a 15-town area. There's also a definition of Concord for occupational employment statistics, which actually is a much larger area, about 33 towns. HUD and the New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority have their own definition of what they think the Concord area looks like, and that pretty much matches the county definition. There are tourism region definitions, hospital service areas in the Concord area, again, is defined slightly differently. The public health folks define Concord a little bit differently in terms of its regional neighbors. And the economic development group probably has the biggest definition that includes the, or the most cities and towns includes Concord. The Capital Regional Development Corporation covers Concord and actually all the way down to Manchester in terms of their service area for that particular regional development corporation. So again, you know, if you're grabbing data, you want to make sure that it's consistent and you're counting the right number of towns from as you move from one definition, regional definition, to another. Again, my apologies. Sometimes about this time of day, my computer starts to freeze up. Just some other sources for data. Quick Facts is a county-level data source from the Census Bureau. There's the URL for that. I already talked a little bit about so-called Bear Facts, which are from the Bureau of Economic Analysis. You can look at location quotients, which I just defined very quickly for you as the ratio of employment in your area to the national average, and whether you're overrepresented or underrepresented. That's a you can make that calculation from the Bureau of Labor Statistics database and county business patterns that I already talked about. IRS statistics of income, again, you can get data at for states, for counties, and even for zip codes from the IRS. There's also a free tool called Melissa Data, which allows you to look at data by zip code. And I've just shown you a table here for zip code 03836, the number of people that are filing the earned income tax credit based on the Melissa Data lookup. New Hampshire Housing is the best source for housing data in the state. They can pull data together on purchase prices. They do the annual rent survey. They also keep track of low-income and subsidized housing in the state of New Hampshire. Our Department of Revenue is the source for property tax data, current use, local finance data. We have some data that we've taken from Department of Revenue to construct sort of a dashboard by town. This is also available on our website, and I've given you the URL for that. And just this is a look at Concord for the years 2001, 2007, and 2014. Really sort of a balance sheet for the city. This is all data that came from our Department of Revenue, which we essentially summarized so it was easier to look at. The top shows spending in the city of Concord over those years, the annual percent change, and to the right we show that data on a per capita basis and the percent change in that. The bottom part shows revenue sources for the town of Concord, how much money is coming from the local property tax and what portion of the property tax, how much Concord's getting from licenses and fees, and again, it all balances out. You know, revenues usually match expenses, at least one hopes they do. And so again, that's data that may be of interest to people that you're building the community profile for. Just wanted to take a minute to talk about this new cool tool that the Census Bureau has released. It's called On the Map, and there's the URL for it. Very easy to use. I think I'd suggest that you take a minute to experiment with it. And what On the Map does is it's a cooperative data effort between the Census Bureau and the local state labor department that allows you very easily to create a map that shows where people work and where they live. So this is a work area profile analysis for the greater Concord area. Each of those dots on the map represents an area where people work, and then the darker the dots or the bigger the dots, the more people are there. So it's a really interesting way to look at the city of Concord. And as I said, you can also, I haven't showed it on the slide, but you can also do this analysis looking at where people live. And I think what you'd find is if you looked at the polygon and where people live, you'd see a lot fewer in the center city and a lot more people kind of living in the outskirts. So it's, again, and statistics available from that analysis are shown in tables on the left and right-hand side of this. So it's, again, it's a pretty neat thing. New Hampshire was one of the last states to participate in this program. Massachusetts and I think one other state still haven't participated in it in terms of sharing this data so that this kind of data can be looked at. But again, encourage you to explore it, take a look at it. Some miscellaneous sources that are available out there. Melissa Data is a free site that lets you look at data by zip code. If you're interested in doing what's called a circle analysis, in other words, sort of drawing a circle around a center point, say in the middle of your town, and to calculate, well, how many people are within a 10-mile, 20-mile, 30-mile radius of my town, what income do they have, what are their characteristics, the Missouri State Data Center actually provides that as a free service. You can get housing starts from the Census Bureau, and if you're interested in statistics on crime, that's available from the Bureau of Justice in the UCR data set, Uniform Crime Report data set, and that's shown at the bottom. Just some final thoughts is on this subject is that I'd suggest that a good way to start this, in addition to probably starting at the Employment Security website, take a look at what some other cities and towns have done to develop community profiles or information for their area. There's a couple of that I've shown you right there. The Concord Main Street Project, I think, is a pretty good site right now, not only in terms of providing data for the city of Concord, but also in trying to keep people apprised of the construction project that's going on in Main Street. For those of you who haven't been to Concord recently, you'll find that there's quite a bit of construction going on. They're essentially redesigning the entire Main Street in the center of town. The project will be done, hopefully, by this fall, and I think it's turning out to be, I think, a good thing for the city, but it's been a little difficult to get around here over the spring and summer. And InTown Manchester is another example of a Main Street project that has pretty good data that explains what Manchester is and some of the, not only the data for Manchester, but also some of the events that are going on in the area. I think charts are always good because they draw the eye, they explain the data. Remember to document what you've done. I mean, if you put a lot of work into this and develop a lot of data, keep track of where you get information from. It's easy to forget to do that at the time, but when it comes to time to update the information that you put together a year from now, you're going to be happy if you did things like keep track of the URLs and the names of the data sets and so on. And I'll just, you probably have questions at this point. Again, we have about 10 minutes left, so I'd be happy to take questions from you. But my question to you as a group is, how would you use all of this to foster economic development in your own communities? And I'll stop there.
Hi, Dennis and group. This is Sarah.
Just one last thing. All of our data at the Center for Public Policy Studies is available on our website, nhpolicy.org. This presentation will be up there as well, but I know you'll also have access to it through UNH. We also have a Facebook page. We have a Twitter account. We have a policy blog that we publish current data that we're interested in on. Look, we even have a phone number. So all of our stuff is available free to the public. We encourage, including this presentation, we encourage people to use that. And I will stop there.
Thank you, Dennis. Again, this is Sarah, and I'm going to moderate questions. We already have a question, Dennis, and it's, if you're comparing statistics, county, community, state, U.S., or year to year, and there is a large outlier, do you try to explain that outlier? So, for example, year-to-year historic spending for Concord showed a huge jump in county spending between 01 and 07. Do outliers discount the overall data? Hello?
Did you mute?
So Dennis should be on here. He's not muted according to my screen. So, Dennis, can you hear us?
Wow.
Well, I see a note that Dennis just sent. It seems like he got cut off. He can't hear anything. So, given this, we might have to type back to him, and he might have to answer this by through the question box. So, until we can figure out the audio.
I think in the meantime, if people just type their questions in, we'll start to accumulate them.
Yep. And one thing that I would note, one of the panelists asked about if they could access this presentation. We will be posting this presentation to Moodle, and I'm recording this presentation as well, so we'll have a video available on the Moodle site. So. Oh, so Justin was just saying the phones went out at the state office a few minutes ago, so this maybe this is why Dennis is affected as well. So it looks like we may not be getting him back online. So please type your questions in, as Sarah indicated, and we'll try and get back to Dennis so he can respond to those. Sarah, I will type Dennis if you can sort of continue moderating the questions.
Okay. We have another question that refers to a template. Is there a good template out there for an economic development strategic plan? Or is there a community that has done one that is particularly good? We had a question from someone who was in last year's class about access to the Moodle site to get a copy of the presentation. We'll make sure that that's available to last year's class as well, and I'll make a note of that. Andre, are you on?
I'm still here.
Can you take a shot at the question about a good template for an economic development strategic plan, if you've seen one that was particularly good in your career?
Well, that's a good one. Actually, the most comprehensive economic development plan that I see is produced through through the economic development districts. Like the Stratford Regional Planning Commission had recently done a what's called a SEDS, comprehensive economic development strategy, and it's done on a region based or their region, but it gives you good information with regard to the types of projects that are derived from that information. On another regional scale, the Cooperative Extension had done an economic development assessment slash profile for the Grafton County Economic Development Corp, and we were able to not only just do the profile, the economic profile as Dennis laid out. But we were also able to look at the economic development sections of each of the 39 communities' master plans to kind of glean out, based on the profile, what types of projects and what types of economic development they could potentially pursue from the viewpoint of the Economic Development Corporation.
And so those plans, I would assume, the Grafton County plan as well as the Stratford Regional Planning Commission's plan are documents that we probably could post on the Moodle site as resources?
I would think so, yeah.
Yes, we can.
I know ours, the one that Co-op Extension is easily reproduced.
Hello. Can people hear me?
Yes, we can. There's a little echo, but we can hear you.
Okay, sorry. I lost audio on my headset probably about 20 minutes ago. So I don't know whether people heard everything I said or not.
This is Dennis DeLay.
Dennis, this is Charlie. We're getting a little bit of feedback here, but we did hear your presentation, and I think you cut out just as we got to the questions. And we were just responding. Okay. To a couple of the questions. One, Sarah, I'll let you, if you want, Sarah, you can chime in with those questions.
Okay, the first question, Dennis, had to do with the data in the, let me get back to the exact wording here. So if you're comparing statistics, community, county, state, US or year to year, and there's a large outlier, do you explain that outlier? Or basically, do you come up with some kind of a way to discount it? So I think the question is around how to explain or not explain those blips in the data.
I think the easiest way to deal with that is by averaging data over years. For example, if you were going to show crime statistics for a small city or town. Probably the best thing to do is to average your crime statistics over a five-year period. We did a crime report a few years ago, and that's the approach that we took. Especially for violent crime, those statistics can move around quite a bit from one year to the next. And it's perfectly acceptable to average data over time to compare either the history or to other parts of the state.
Okay, so basically averaging the information over time, particularly when you have something startling, you use crime statistics as the example so that it doesn't represent that time span. Another question had to do with your experience and knowledge of plans that are out. So can you think of any good templates or good community economic development strategic plans that would be examples for the, for our participants?
Probably the thing that comes to mind immediately is the Regional Economic Development Corporation, which is one of the economic development groups that covers Rockingham County and actually down into Nashua, does an annual economic plan. They call it a CEDES, C-E-D-E-S, Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. And it's a really good document. I actually was a contributor to it a couple of years ago. And I think they recently released their five-year plan. So I think the website is redc.com. And there's probably more information in that document that you might care to develop for an individual community, but again, it's a very good example, I think, of the kind of economic profile that you could develop for a region or a municipality.
Okay, so that's redc.com would be a good example of one of those. And you may not have heard, Andre also chimed in with a few suggestions of the Stratford Regional Planning and the Grafton County.
Yep, I think those are good too. I'm not as familiar with those, but I think again the economic development groups in the state have to do economic profiles of their areas in order to get some of the funding that they need. This also applies to the regional planning commissions, so groups like Southern New Hampshire Planning Commission, the Nashua Planning Commission, the Lake Sunapee Regional Planning Commission, the Capital Area Regional Planning Commission, they all have requirements to provide economic data, profile data. So that would also be another good source.